Meow.
Now that you've tasted cuisines from over 30 countries, we'd like to formally welcome you to Harriton's first annual International Night. Tonight we're going to go on a journey throughout every corner of the globe. I'm Remy.
And I'm Nina.
And we're going to be your hosts.
Before we get started with these incredible performances, we'd like to introduce our very special guest, Cameron Wright, the author of The Rent Collector. After much consideration, The Rent Collector was selected for Lower Merion School District's One Book, One School reading program.
Every Harriton student and staff member has had the pleasure of reading this book, and we're fortunate enough tonight to have Mr. Cameron Wright himself here to talk about it. Without further ado, Mr. Cameron Wright.
Need my grandpa glasses. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. What an amazing school, amazing kids. It's really just an opportunity. There was a man who was learning English for the very first time, and he was eager to begin using a lot of the words that he was using or learning. And so at a bus stop, he struck up a conversation with a man who was standing next to him. And he said to him, "You know, every time I try and say a new word, my tongue gets all twisted up." And his friend interrupted his new friend, and he said, "You know, sir, I don't mean to be rude, but the word's not tongue-y, it's pronounced tongue." And the first man replied, he said, "Oh, I'm so sorry, that keeps happening to me a lot." And he said, "The way you guys spell your words in English, everything's so vague-y that it's difficult to keep it all straight." The second man interrupted again, and he said, "No, I've got news for you. It's actually vague. The word is pronounced vague, not vague-y." And then the man paused and he thought for a second. He said, "Hey, I have a rule that might help." He said, "Every time you see the UE together at the end of a word, it's silent. So it's not tongue-y, it's tongue. And it's not vague-y, it's vague." By this time, the first man flustered, had thrown his hands up into the air, and he replied, "Okay, fine, let's not argue about it." And so that's really kind of what life is about, you know. We're just all trying to figure out the rules, understand what everything means, get along the very best that we can. To that end, I commend you tonight for your effort. You know, what an amazing program and event here tonight. Part of the money that you're raising tonight will be going to the Cambodian Children's Fund, CCF, an organization in Cambodia. It started by a man named Scott Neeson. I thought I'd tell you just a little bit about the history behind this charity, because it's quite amazing. I first became aware of the organization through my son, Trevor. Trevor knows Scott. He spent some time in Cambodia doing some volunteer work for this organization. Before starting CCF, Scott Neeson was a bigwig in Hollywood. And when I say bigwig, Scott was the president of 20th Century Fox International. He was an executive at Sony Pictures. The films that Scott was in charge of, that he oversaw, there were movies like Titanic, Braveheart, X-Men, all these massive Hollywood blockbusters. Scott drove a Porsche. He lived in a ritzy mansion in Brentwood. He lived two doors down from Cindy Crawford, the supermodel. He was just, you know, things were happening for him. I read one article on Scott that said he was earning $1 million a year salary. So he was kind of a mover and shaker in Hollywood. Well, Scott was in Cambodia just vacationing in between movies, and he stumbled across the Stung Mean Che Dung. And while he was there, he noticed the orphan kids kind of working in the trash. And Scott's a decent guy, and he thought to himself, "You know what, I have plenty of money. I should do something to try and help these kids." And so he set up the Cambodian Children's Fund. Its sole purpose was to take these kids out of the dump, out of this environment, give them a chance to get an education and hopefully have a better life. Well, for 2 years after he set up his charity, he commuted back and forth. So he'd be in LA doing his movie thing, and then once a month he'd jump on a plane, head over to Cambodia to try and keep this fledgling organization going. Well, 2 years go by, Scott's in the dump. He's actually trying to save a couple of little Cambodian girls who are there. And while in the middle of doing that, he gets a call on his cell phone. On the other end of the line is a powerful Hollywood agent. This agent is at the airport, and he's standing next to his client, who's a well-known Hollywood actor. The actor is about to get on a private jet that Sony Pictures has provided, and the actor is furious because the amenities on the jet are not the amenities that he was expecting. I asked Trevor, I said, "Any idea what it was?" And he said, "Dad, I don't know for certain. I'm not sure, but I heard that it was something like the brand of water that he requested was not the brand of water that was on the jet." And so Scott's listening to this rant, and then through his phone, Scott hears this actor say to his agent, "My life was not meant to be this difficult." I mean, can you imagine? He's at the dump, you know, trying to save these girls. And he says, "That's it. I've had it. I'm not doing this anymore." So Scott walks away from the yachts, the cars, the parties, the mansions, the prestige. He moves to Cambodia full-time to run this organization. He used his own money until his money ran out. When his money ran out, then he naturally turned to his friends in Hollywood. And so I know Oprah's a big contributor. A lot of movie stars contribute to the cause. Trevor said that when he worked for Scott, there were 200 children in the school. Today there are, and he said, by a matter of fact, he said he knew all of those children. He said he knew every child by name. He knew their families, their backgrounds, their histories. Today there are about 2,500 children in the school. So he's literally changing thousands of these families' lives in Cambodia. When Trevor worked for Scott, they had just one location, and now they have 9 different locations around the city. And when I say locations, Scott had all these children in his school that he was feeding, and so he was buying a lot of bread. And so he opened a bakery. And not only is the bread cheaper, but he's teaching the kids how to be bakers and accountants and everything associated with that type of a business. CCF, they recently opened up a restaurant in Phnom Penh. And so, again, teaching the kids how to be waiters and cooks and waitresses and everything that it takes to run that type of a business. So he's not just teaching them to read and write, but he's giving them a skill that will enable them to go out into the job market once they finish school and actually, you know, get a job. So he's like this modern-day, you know, Mother Teresa. To this day, he actually has no car, no home. He lives in the offices kind of above CCF. The thing, too, I love, if you ask him if he misses the lifestyle, I love his answer. He said, "Well, to be completely honest, you know, yeah, I owned a sports car. How could I not miss it?" But then he paused and he said, "But you know what? I've never been happier." Let me tell you one more insightful story about Scott. In the book, I write about kind of the gangs in the dump, and they were a problem. When I went back in late 2012, the dump had already closed, and so the gangs were no longer there. They weren't an issue. But when Trevor was there filming the documentary, they were still a problem. In fact, he said on the first day of filming, and then these are kids who are bigger than most of the Khmer people. They speak the language, they've lived there. So he said, "Dad, I've never been afraid in Cambodia." But he said they were there at the dump, and while they were filming, they noticed a kid watching them, and he was pretty far away. And he watched him for nearly an hour. And then all of a sudden, he jumped on his bike, and he took off. And the lady that they were filming, she noticed this, and she got all concerned. And she said, "You guys need to get out of here now." She said, "He's a member of one of the gangs." And she said, "He's been watching you for so long to know exactly how many of you there are. So he knows how many gang members to bring back. He says they're going to beat you up, and they're going to steal your equipment." Trevor said it was the first time that he was suddenly nervous. And I said, "Well, what did you do?" And he said, "Well, one, we got out of there. We took off." And then he said, "But then we went and talked to Scott." And he said, the first thing Scott did when he got into the country and decided to set up this charity is he walked into the police station. And he kind of looked around and he noticed they had a leaky roof in the police station. So he put a brand new roof on the police station. So the smart man, you know, the police will do anything for Scott. Trevor said from that day on, they had an armed policeman who just kind of followed him around like a puppy at the dump. And so they didn't really have any problems after that. So I'm thankful for people like Scott, not just people who are smart, but genuinely compassionate people. Seriously, I mean, I would be the guy in a fancy Hollywood office who would write out the check and hand it off and pat myself on the back for, you know, being such a good guy. Well, Scott's willing to go there in person to get his hands dirty, so to speak, and you know, you can't help but love the man for that. The thing I realize, though, is we all can't be Scott, you know, and I don't think we're really meant to be. Will Rogers, he once said, "We all can't be heroes because somebody has to sit on the curb and clap as they go by." And, you know, right? I mean, it's true. So for those of us on the curb, there's so much that we can do. You know, we live in a world of selfies, of Facebook, a kind of look at me, what I'm doing now, society. And so it's refreshing when we can step out of ourselves and focus our attention on the needs of others. And you know, when we do amazing things happen, and that's kind of really what you're about here tonight, so it's so great. Researchers at Ohio State University, they studied happiness using the movie Titanic, one of the most popular films of all time, and as they studied it, They studied it to understand really why it was so popular. They discovered that it wasn't the special effects, it wasn't the acting, it wasn't even the fact that it was a love story. But they found that it was the story caused people to think more deeply about their own relationships. And it was that that boosted their happiness. They noted that the subjects who had self-centered thoughts about the movie, as in, you know, at least my life's not as bad as theirs, they didn't see an increase in happiness. It was only those who focused on the relationships in their lives that felt the boost. That's pretty amazing. They went on to say, further still, those who thought the most about these relationships felt the greatest increase in happiness. It's so profound, really, that you know, it's the relationships that matter. But you know, they're not always easy. They take work. I was once given two words of advice for writing, but for writing it had proved beneficial. The two words were butt and chair. The person offering the advice said if I would sit my butt in my chair for a certain number of hours each day, that I would soon be able to finish my novel. And it works, I can tell you that. But that said, I believe the opposite is also true. There are times when we need to get our butts out of our chairs and push ourselves out of our own little world and into the world of others and develop and tend our relationships. And sometimes, like with writing, it needs to be a forced effort. We have to force ourselves to do it. But when we do, when we make the effort, the results will almost always prove productive. So I applaud you. Your butts are out of your chairs, metaphorically speaking, because right now they are in your chairs. But you know, you're here raising money for others, and that's such a cool thing. Let me touch just for a quick moment on the, one of the book's main themes, that being kind of the importance of reading and learning literature. I've been intrigued for years by the same repeating themes that occur over and over again in popular literature. The Cinderella story is a perfect example of that, and I kind of reference that in the book. You can take nearly any culture in any period of time, even isolated cultures, and they all seem to have their own Cinderella story. And you know, I shake my head and think, how is that possible? In researching the literature for the story, I read many pieces of classical literature, perhaps hundreds, and I was enthralled. I found it astonishing that you can take a piece of literature that was written 100 or 1,000 years ago, and it can be every bit as relevant today as the day that it was written. The lessons don't fade. I learned that words are powerful. I learned that stories convey great meaning with important purpose, and I would contend it's not by accident. I believe that as people, we love stories about keeping hope alive, because in our own lives, we're not supposed to give up hope. We love stories, we clap at stories about second chances, because inside we realize we all mess up, and we maybe understand that we're all in need of second chances. We crave stories about love, because that's kind of the universal glue that holds everything together. Let me end with an example that's kind of close to home on the most basic level. When Trevor first met Sang Lee, she told him that she didn't know how to read. And he soon figured out that she actually can read, just not very well. But since we've reconnected with her, she's been practicing, she's been reading more often, she's been trying to read every day. And a few months ago, she made a comment that I found absolutely fascinating. She said, "Now that I'm reading more, I'm not as scared to be at the dump at night." I mean, isn't that amazing that for her, reading, this correlation between reading and confidence, you know, she derives courage from reading. And I think that's amazing. It's courage that's direct and noticeable. I think that she stumbled across a principle that really applies to all of us. It applies to everyone. We too will take the time to read, to consider, to ponder, to understand. We'll also find increased courage and confidence in our lives. My hope is that we can do that, and that we can then use that courage to kind of get further out of our comfort zones in both developing and nurturing our relationships and also in helping others. And to that end, I sincerely thank you for your time tonight, and again, commend you on this great event. Thank you very much.
Let's give another hand.
Before we embark on the rest of our journey, we're going to kick things off with a little good old-fashioned American rap.
Without further ado, here's Kayla Bernstein, a.k.a. Candy Rapper,
with a K,
ready with her original rap. Without further ado, here's Kayla.
Thank you. tells me it'll be alright. But I'll get frustrated when she doesn't hear me right. Did you hear the iPhone 7 just came out tonight? My stupid iPhone 6 is full, my God, I hate my life. Now don't pretend you never speak those words. This is native language of the suburbs. Searching for a blemish in the golden light. Because we're both with having everything we want in sight.
Подают нам голоса. Oh,
before our next act, and I'd like to introduce Sutton Sharma, head of the International Night Committee, to talk about the proceeds, the booths, and more.
Make sure to stop at Annie Ann's in Terminal B, and we'll see you soon.
Adios.
So how is everyone enjoying tonight? I saw fathers and daughters, Mr. Galvin and his daughter, Mr. Owen and his daughter, walking around to each of the booths, and I saw them getting the passport signed, stories were shared. It was absolutely wonderful, and that is what tonight is about. All of the cultures, traditions, and stories coming together in a place of love and celebration. We left malice and prejudice at the door, and I think it's so important that these kind of events are the glue to our community. I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for coming out here tonight. It's been a 5-month journey, and I'm going to refer to my notes, so just bear with me because I don't want to miss anything important. But the idea of International Night came to me a year ago when I moved from Jones Creek, Georgia to Fort Marion, Philadelphia. And like any vision, it cannot become a reality until you have a passionate team behind you to spin it into reality. So, Lizzie Birmingham, David Naftalin, Kira Baldwin, Andrea Salas, Tate Zerletti, and Raphael Satra, please stand up right now. She couldn't be here tonight because of a family matter, but she's here in spirit, and I cannot thank her enough for really guiding us through this whole process. And a humongous thank you goes out to Ms. Marcusen and Mr. Tom O'Brien because they took a chance on a group of students with a vision and really allowed us to make this our own. And so we cannot thank them enough for allowing us to use the facility, staying after for rehearsals, just did the whole nine yards, and we cannot thank them enough. So big round of applause for this all. Now, to every single one of you sitting in the audience, your presence is just about the coolest thing because not only did you spend $5 to get in, get some food, listen to some awesome music, see some dancing, but every single one of those dollars is going straight halfway around the world to a community in Nepal to build them back on their feet. As many of you know, tragedy struck Nepal earlier this year when the earthquake happened, and all of the proceeds from tonight go to two very worthy organizations, Nepal Health Girls School and Microloans for Moms, which focus on empowerment of females and creating a ripple effect in the community. Nepal House Girls School was built in 2010 by my brother, Kayla Sharma, and it focuses on the empowerment of girls in the community, because many times these girls are told, no, you're not good enough. No, you can't have a future. No, you cannot dream. But with just a little love and affection, these girls, who many of whom were rescued from the sex trade and prostitution, have just flourished. They are advancing. Many of them have transitioned back into the sister schools, and they're doing incredible things because we've told them, yes, you can. Microloans for Moms is an initiative that was started last year, and it basically focuses on illiterate mothers. The first kickoff is in Nepal, and it's going to be a global template we kind of use, but it's for illiterate mothers to gain economic emancipation from abusive situations. So we teach them a certain skill, or how to make something, or how to sell something, and then we teach them, okay, this is how you save, this is how you run a household. And this creates creates a ripple effect in the community, because it's been proven that when you educate a girl, she will stay in the community and help it grow. Whereas if you educate a boy, he will go all the way to the US or to Britain and find more opportunities. So now I have a really huge favor to ask of all of you. I know you have wonderful ideas and visions, so please, please, please tell all the teachers who helped out, the incredible principals, because we want this event to become an ongoing event that we pass on to the rising seniors and really make part of the hallowed traditions of Harriton High School. Before I close out, I want to single it over to the real heroes of the night, those of you who took the time out to, lots and lots of time, I know, because it's crazy in the beginning of the year, but those of you who spent lots of time on boots, please stand up. Students who made this happen. So there's 15 minutes more of the show, and without further ado, here it is. Thank you so much.
We're back. Hope you're ready for this flight. It's gonna be a long one, but we're prepared. I think we're going all the way to Mexico.
Andrea will be covering a song by the lovely Selena. Come on, Mom Knows. Everybody, let's go.
Sing it.
Go get it.
song. Anyway, guys, we really are flying all over the place tonight. We're going back overseas to India, where these fabulous outfits are from and where I lived last year. I'm super excited to relive my experience for the next 3 minutes.
Here's Saika and Sarah performing an Indian fusion song. I know you'll enjoy.
So when Saika asked me if I'd play a tune, for International Night? I said, absolutely. And my first frame of reference was the tunes as a child and teenager growing up in an Irish-American household full of music. So I reintroduced myself to those tunes and I said, oh my God, they're all great tunes, which one do I pick? And then one spoke to me because I heard So Cute in the song. It's kind of a tearjerker, but if you listen to the lyrics and sort of between the lines, So Pete said something about that perplexing nature of hope that is inherent in humanity, and this tune speaks to that.
Yeah. $85 in value.
Applause ready for beer.